New Britain, Connecticut. I am just waking up, so bear with me for a bit here. I haven't had one sip of coffee yet. Yep. We are currently heading over to a TA.
In 1 mile, keep left to Connecticut 72 West.
About 12 miles out from where we are right now. Yep. Ended up, making our delivery last night, or USPS, with no problems. And basically immediately, not even immediately after.
Be in the left lane.
Immediately before making that delivery, got it getting dispatched to another load. That picked up about
in 1 mile. Keep left to I-84 West.
I don't know, I think it was like 40 miles or 50 miles away from the USPS over at Amazon. So yeah, I got dispatched to that just before making that delivery. So I made the delivery and then headed over to go pick up that load. And I was at an Amazon facility back there. Whatever the name of the town that I was just in was called. I don't remember off the top of my mind. And, got checked in at the gate.
Any of the three left lanes.
Here for a live load. Oh, okay. He says, oh, it's already been loaded. Of course it has. Big surprise, right?
Continue on I-84.
So yeah, so they loaded this in one of their own trailers. So like actually a white rental trailer. And it said, yeah, no, that's not gonna work. It needs to be loaded in our trailer. We won't take it in your trailer. They said, oh, okay, well, we'll see what we can do. And the girl was working there. There was a guy and a girl, and the girl came up. She's like, oh wow, that's, well, we'll see if we can transload it into your trailer. She's like, man, but it's, I don't know if we have the crew here to do it. She says, it's I just moved to that trailer, she says, and there's a lot in it. That's what she said. That's what she said. That's the language she used. There's a lot in it, like as if to say it's really heavy when she moved it. Okay. Well, whatever. So they ho-hummed about it for, uh-oh, 30 or 45 minutes, and then called me and says, yeah, we're going to go ahead and do it. Go ahead and pull into this dock over here. So I went and grabbed the dock door and dropped my trailer off and bobtailed, just, you know, whatever, down to the end of their yard where they have people bobtail or park bobtail waiting for trailers to be loaded, I guess. And a couple hours or so go by, and I had actually said, you know what, I'm just going to go ahead and see if I can catch a couple hours of sleep, if, you know, whatever it takes, if it's a big trip, you know, a big load or whatever. So I laid down, and it's just, you know, timing. You know, the moment that I fell asleep, they called me and said, oh, it's ready now. Okay. And that was at, I don't know, like 3 a.m., I think, or something. And they called me and said, it's ready. heavy load that it would happen. So I go to check out, and the guy hands me my BOL and my seal. I'm reading as I'm walking back to go close the doors on the trailer, I'm reading the BOL just to get an idea of, you know, what's in there and how heavy it actually is. And it's like the only weight numbers that I see say 1,894 pounds or whatever it says. But there was no two, there was a one. It was a 1,000, not even a ton. I'm like, huh. Maybe it's like a bunch of these, you know, 1 3/4 ton pallets, right, or something. Okay. So I walk back and close my doors, and it's just like two or three pallets stuffed way up at the front of the trailer. Maybe more than two or three. Maybe four or five, six, maybe. And it's like nothing in the trailer, hardly at all. Barely anything. Cop walking over like towards my truck as I'm sitting there at that light.
Arriving at Travel Centers of America on the left.
So I was sitting there at that light. The cop was over there working with the road crew or helping a road crew or something like that. He starts walking over to my truck. I'm like, huh, what are you doing? But yeah, so I got to the Amazon and had like a quarter tank of fuel. And when I rolled out of there, I just rolled up the street and basically parked the truck to get some sleep. Left it running, of course, it was in the 30s. Wake up this morning and it's like down to an eighth of a tank. I'm like, oh God, there better be someplace to fuel really close by. So I'm getting lucky that this place
is close
to me. Please
drive to highlighted route.
Actually.
In 1/2 mile, turn left on I-84 West.
Yep. Pretty lucky. So, anyhow, we'll see you all a little bit. Off we go. We are fueled up and off we go. Feeling much better about it too, I gotta say. I was in there kind of daydreaming as I make my way to the exit here. But yeah,
1/4 mile, turn left on I-84 West.
It feels much better to see the needle on the opposite side of the pendulum there, I guess, on the opposite side of the gauge. Way here, Sheila. Uh-oh. Am I exiting the wrong way, or what are we doing? We should be going,
In 1/4 mile, turn left on I-84 West.
Yeah, okay, that's what I thought. There's the cop right there standing on the corner in the black with the yellow vest that came walking over towards my truck when I was at the medium there at this light. They're like, what? What are you gonna tell me? He's just like, hey, good morning, or whatever he said. He's like, hey. He actually, yeah, when he came walking up, I was like, you know, that's exactly the kind of guy what you picture in your mind of being, like, the cool all around, just like honest sheriff or officer, like just
turn
way
left at the traffic light
appeared to the eye, right? Like the first impression was like, oh, this guy looks like a honest guy, you know, like rather than the other kind of officers that you see so much of the time. may be honest. They may be honest. They may be honestly just ripping us off at every chance that they get, because that's supposedly their duty. And I'll say this, because I'm not going to go all into a bunch of stuff right now about it, but, you know, with all this stuff going on, political environment right now, you know, and I mean, the obvious, now completely out in the open threat of socialism, communism, fascism, right here on our soil, completely out in the open, basically not even attempting to hide it anymore. And looking at the last few decades to see how this has been leading up to where it is now, and, you know, the way the government's been headed, basically, and the more and more it's been imposing itself upon people, and you think and you say, well, what is government, right? And it's like, oh, government is there to tell people what to do. It's kind of like that's government's the authority of man, right? Mankind. Well, no, that's the perception that they want people to have. The truth is, because government did not create man. Man created government. Period. So man is the authority over government. Period. Right? So anything that government does against man, right, is not only, you know, immoral and ethical, illegal and lawful, all that stuff. It's just wrong. Yeah, I mean, I guess that kind of says it all. It's just it goes against the nature of things, by all means, right? So you say, well, what did man create government to do? Well, man created government in order to allow man to enjoy his life and his time without having to constantly look over his shoulder for the threats that may be coming against him, right? Domestically or foreign, right? Or whatever. That's why we created government. It's so that we can live our lives and enjoy it, and that basically, so some of us, we pay people, right, who are part of the population in the country we live, to be on guard for us for one third of the time, right? And we pay them to do that, right? To make sure that things aren't taken from us, that our rights aren't taken from us, our freedoms aren't taken from us, that we can live our lives comfortably and not in constant concern and worry about, hey, what's coming up behind me, right? At the point that the government becomes the threat itself and starts making life more difficult, and when you start having to look over your shoulder because of the government that you created, you've got a big problem on your hands. And that's exactly what, the quote-unquote founding fathers were aware of could happen when they, you know, wrote the Constitution, Bill of Rights, Declaration of Independence. That's exactly the stuff. They were aware of all that stuff, and they wrote it in preemptively, right? So that way, you know, they could try and create something that would be incorruptible, right? But they knew, you know, that things, you know, it doesn't, you know, nothing is absolutely incorruptible, right? And, well, that's what we're dealing with right now. So people better wake up, because government wasn't created to make our lives more difficult. It was to make our lives better. It was to make our lives easier, smoother, and happier, and more comfortable. Not to make us uncomfortable, not to make us unhappy, not to steal from us, not to take things from us, not to make us nervous, not to be intimidating, not to make us put us in fear, all that bullshit that we are dealing with right now and we have been dealing with here in this country for decades. So, yeah, it's a big problem. So people need to fucking wake up, period. That's it. I hope that happens. But I am in fear that it's not going to. I mean, you know, people still have this perception that things are, oh, this is the way things are. You know, oh, government's our authority. Bullshit. Bullshit, you need to wake up. I mean, it's like in the jungle, you got the lions, right? And all of a sudden the lion, you know, and let's say, you know, the impala out there, the deer, right, or whatever, they're tired of getting harassed by the hyenas. It's like, man, we just can't even, you know, be comfortable. We're always nervous about these freaking hyenas. They're always coming after us. They're always messing with us, right? Let's talk to the lions and see if the lions can kind of, you know, we'll pay the lions. We'll let the lions know when there's, you know, something to eat or, you know, whatever. We'll let them know where the good water is. You know, we'll give them something for watching our backs, you know, from these hyenas, right? And so lions are like, all right, yeah, because, you know, where we are, you know, it's hard to find water, especially, you know, in the summer. Oh, well, we're the deer. We go everywhere, so we know where everything is. All right. And next thing you know, the hyenas are being, kept from enjoying their lives by the lions. And not only that, they find out that the lions were the ones telling the hyenas where the deer were, right? That's basically what we got. It was a setup. They were like, how are we gonna get these deer to come to us and ask us for help? Well, let's go talk to the hyenas, and let's tell the hyenas, you know, start messing with these deer,
of the two left lanes,
and make them believe that we're on their side, right? And they'll come to us and ask for protection from you. and when they do, you know, we can all feast off of them. What the hell, right? That's basically what we got going on. So anyhow, I'll wrap that up. That's enough of that. So, with all that, let's do a check-in here. We've got a fresh day. We got Thursday, December 3rd, current local time of 11:38 in the a.m. Anti-meridium. Current temperature outside, 46 degrees. About 10 or 12 or 13 degrees warmer than it was overnight. Elevation 380 feet. And we're currently I-84 westbound en route to someplace in Ohio. I forget what the name of the city is. I'll tell you in a second here, just to be proper about it. now, if I can. By the way, we are going through, I believe, Southbury Town. Yeah, Southbury Town, Connecticut. This is a beautiful state, actually. This is the most I've seen of it, actually, so far for all the driving I've already done through it. It's all I still haven't finished my coffee here yet, so it's pretty well, for the most part, been during the night that I've driven through. Got a couple of glimpses, but, it's actually, gorgeous out here. I had no idea, I had no idea how beautiful it would be in Connecticut. those trucks a minute ago, but...